Thank you very much. So it's great to see so many of you here. Speaks well about the health and the excitement of the field. And I would also like to thank the Institute for Advanced Study and Chiara in particular for hosting this wonderful event. So in the next three lectures, I'd like to tell you about topological string, which is a set of techniques to compute a certain physical amplitude of superstring compactified on the Carabiel manifold. And it's also a beautiful theory on its own, so I'd be very happy to tell you about that. Since it's videotaped, I'd like to apologize in advance that I will not be able to give a complete list of references during the lectures. I provide those references primarily for those of you who want to follow up on what I'm going to say and read more details. So when I give seven-digit archive numbers, that's going to be HEP-TH number, eight-digit archive numbers. So this is my plan, so you can read it. I will try to write a little bit larger later. And so the first I'd like to tell you about Carabiel manifold. And Martin has already told you quite a bit about it, and I'll focus on different aspects of this construction, but very briefly. As Martin said, that Carabiel plays a very essential role in string theory since it's a solution to Einstein equation and preserves supersymmetry. So for example, if you consider type 2 on four-dimension times Carabiel manifold, well, suppose we don't know about this manifold yet, so some six-dimensional space, then in general, the spin connection on this six manifold is SO6 gauge field, which is the same as SU4 locally. And if you have a spinner in six dimension, then this can be decomposed into 4 plus 4 bar under SU4. And assuming that the metric has non-trivial configuration, assuming that only metric has non-trivial configuration, that other fields are turned off, then the condition for supersymmetry is that you have a covariantly constant spinner. And from that, Martin explained to you that this holonomy SU4 should get reduced to the little group which preserves this spinner, which is SU3. Okay? So under this SU3, this 4 plus 4 get decomposed into 1 plus 3 plus 3 bar plus 1. And so you have two covariantly constant spinner. So if you denote one of them by epsilon naught, then the other one would be I times gamma 7 times epsilon naught. So in this case, they have opposite chirality. Gamma 7 is gamma 1, gamma 2, gamma 3 product of six of them. Okay? So let me briefly tell you the characterization of this Carabiel manifold. Okay? So in order to some of the local feature of Riemannian manifold can be classified by the holonomy. And holonomy is closely connected to the supersymmetry. So the understanding the connection between holonomy and supersymmetry is important. So let me denote by n plus and minus be the number of covariantly constant spinner of plus and minus chirality. Okay, and then try to list some of these. So for example, if the manifold has SOD holonomy, where D is a real dimension of the manifold, then obviously there are no supersymmetry. If D is actually 2n and holonomy is un, you still don't have supersymmetry, but the manifold has a special feature called Kähler. And it's a complex manifold, and its metric, Gij bar, can be written as del I del j bar of k, where k is called Kähler potential. So now comes the Carabiel manifold. So Carabiel manifold has SUn holonomy. And In this case, depending on the dimension, so of parity of n, whether n is even or odd, the number of supersymmetry preserved or number of covariantly constant spinner is either 1, 1, that is when n is odd, or 2, 0, when n is even. Well, it's easy to understand why that is the case, because remember in the case of Calabiao, the two covariantly constant spinners are related by this gamma matrix. And they have opposite chirality because gamma 7 flips the chirality. If this n was even, then they would have the same chirality. So that's the reason for this. And this reduction of un to sun requires that u1 part of the curvature vanishes. So that means that rich curvature vanishes. And the great thing about Kähler manifold is that rich curvature has a very simple expression, which is equal to del I del j bar of log of determinant of the metric itself. So that should be zero. So this being zero means that log of determinant of g is sum of holomorphic function and anti-holomorphic function. So if you take out log symbol, then it should be product of holomorphic object and anti-holomorphic object. Namely, it should be omega of x and omega bar of x bar. Okay, so by looking at the transformation property, you see that omega should be holomorphic three-form, and omega bar should be anti-holomorphic three-forms. And moreover, metric should not vanish, determinant of the metric should not vanish because it's a volume form. So that means that if you have a Calabiao rich flat Kähler metric, then you must have holomorphic N0 form, which is nowhere vanishing. And of course, as Martin said, that the converse is true thanks to the Yau's theorem. That if you have a nowhere vanishing holomorphic N0 form, then one can actually solve this equation. This is a this is going to be a nonlinear partial differential equation. And what Yau showed was that there is a unique solution to this equation for a given complex and Kähler structure. Although in this course, I'm just going to tell you about Calabiao, but since I started talk about holonomies, just for the pedagogical purpose, this is supposed to be the summer school, so I just take just 1 minute to tell you other holonomy. So in fact, if the manifold is simply connected and if the holonomy is irreducible, and if the manifold is not symmetric like in the case of anti-Dojita space, then there is a classification of holonomy. So there are actually four other types of holonomy, one of which is SPK times SP1, where dimension of the manifold is multiple of four. And this is called a quaternionic Kähler manifold. This is not rich flat. SP1 part carries the rich tensor. And so and this is not Kähler either, but it is a solution to the Einstein equation with cosmological constant. There is SPK case, which is called hyper-Kähler. And in this case, the number of supersymmetry is given by K plus 1, 0. For example, K equal 1 case is a K3 surface, where you have two covariantly constant spinner with one chirality. And then there are two more cases. One is a holonomy, one has exceptional holonomy of G2, which is a case of dimension 7. And the other is spin 7, which is a case of dimension 8. Okay? So just a brief detour to the classification of holonomy. So it's useful to have back in your mind when you talk about Calabiao some examples. So I just want to give you one example of Calabiao, which was also featured in Martin's talk, but I just wanted to tell you about some other aspect of it. So example. Okay. So consider CP n plus 1. Okay. So this is Kähler, obviously. And this has a natural Chang class. The Chang class of this space is very easy to evaluate. So you just consider J, which is given by GIJ bar, DZI, DZJ bar, for this space, and this can be proportional to rich curvature. And let's normalize it so that j to the n plus 1 evaluated on CPN is equal to 1. So in this case, the total Chern class is simply given by j plus 1 to the n plus 2. So this is something you can easily look up in any textbook on differential geometry. And now suppose, for example, in this space, you consider degree k polynomial. And set that equal to 0. Then this gives you some hypersurface. And then you can ask, what is the total Chern class of that? Well, there is actually a very simple formula, convenient formula that exists, which is called adjunction formula. So basically, it is given by this divided by, so you impose constraint. So this was the original Chern class. And you impose one constraint of degree k, and what you have to do is just to divide this by the factor corresponding to that constraint. And then you ask, when is this rich flat? When the first Chern class vanishes? Well, you can just expand it, and the first non-trivial term is this. So therefore, this will be Calabi-Yau if, namely, first Chern class is going to be 0 if k is n is equal to n plus 2. Okay, so that's why quintic is an example of Calabi-Yau, because it's Calabi-Yau threefold with k equal 5, which is what we want. And so this is a quintic hypersurface. Okay? For the later purpose, it's convenient to compute other characteristic numbers. So for example, if you further expand it, in this case, it's going to be 1 plus 10 to the j square minus 40 j cube in the case of n equals 3, k equal 5. I just plug that in and expand. And then you can ask what the Euler class of this space. To compute the Euler class, you just compute minus 40 times integral of j cube, right, on this space. Now, how you can compute this on this space? Well, there is, again, a simple formula, because this originally came from the CPN. So therefore, you can relate this computation to the CPN, which is J3, wedged over 5J. And you just need to multiply 5J, because that corresponds to the degree 5 constraint. And this is normalized so that J to the 4th integrated over CP4 is equal to 1. So that gives you 5 times 40, which is minus 200. So this way, you can compute that Euler class of this manifold is 200, which will be useful later. So that's a sort of a brief introduction to Calabi-Yau space. And now, is there any question? OK, so if not, I would like to go on to discuss formulation of topological string. So to formulate topological string, well, first of all, in this lecture, I will just talk about the perturbative formulation of topological string theory. So it's going to be just world sheet theory. So namely, we consider two-dimensional conformal field theory whose target space is Calabi-Yau manifold. And then we're going to integrate it over the moduli space of two-dimensional Riemann surface to define perturbative string amplitude. And so I need to first describe the two-dimensional world sheet theory. Okay, so I'm going to write the standard Lagrangian of 2D sigma model. I realize you can't, those of you who are sitting on that side cannot read on this side. So I'm trying to read, use this part of the chalkboard. So the Lagrangian is going to start with 1/2 of the target space metric with del x mu, del bar x nu, plus the kinetic term for the fermion. And then there is also the four fermion term. But if I write it over here, then those of you who are sitting over there cannot read it. So I'm just going to say that this is curvature times 4 fermion. Okay? So that's the Lagrangian. And this X thing is a map from this Riemann surface into the target space Calabi-Yau manifold. And this is an interacting quantum field theory. And in particular, if the target space is scalar, then you have n equal 2 supersymmetry on the world sheet, not on the target space, but on the world sheet. Okay? So why Calabi-Yau is significant in this context? Well, this is a sigma two-dimensional model, so you can compute the beta function. So you can think of this two-dimensional target space metric as a coupling constant of this sigma model. So that is computing for you the beta function. And if you compute a one-loop beta function, it is proportional to the rich curvature. Okay, so through the leading order in sigma model perturbation, you find that the model will be conformal if the rich tensor is vanishing. If you want to read those kind of technique, then I highly recommend you to take a look at the paper by Alvarez Gomez and Ginsburg in Communication in Mathematical Physics 102, 1985, 311. Okay? However, if you compute higher loop amplitude, then there are corrections to this. So what happened to that correction? Well, in fact, it was discovered by Grisar, Van de Ven, Zanon, that there are counterterms in four loops. So if you go to four loop computation, then it's going to be rich curvature plus something which can be expressed as cube of Riemann curvature. Okay? So this means that the conformal invariant sigma model target space is not exactly Calabi-Yau. There is a modification to it. Fortunately, this is a well-defined function in the target space. And whereas this one is del I del j bar log of determinant of g, and this is not a scalar function. And that is as it should be. Because if this is a globally defined function, the metric rich curvature would have been trivial. Okay? So this is actually a trivial deformation of the Kähler potential. So this does not in particular modify the Kähler class or complex structure of the target space. So another way of saying it is that complex structure or Kähler structure not renormalized. So you can still characterize the model in terms of the complex structure and the Kähler class of the original Calabi-Yau manifold. So this gives us a strategy. Start with Calabi-Yau manifold, and then correct the metric order by order in the alpha prime expansion, which is a loop expansion in the sigma model, and find the conformal invariant model. Okay? And this procedure does not change the complex and the Kähler moduli. However, this poses a significant problem when you actually want to do practical computation. Because, well, there are three issues. One is that, in general, for compact Calabi-Yau, even the rich flat Kähler metric for the original Calabi-Yau is not known. The finding explicit form of those metrics have been a long-standing challenge for mathematicians. And as I said, even if you find such metric, there are alpha prime corrections to order by order, and then you have to correct the metric, and you don't know what you end up with. And finally, even if you find such exact metric, you have interacting conformal field theory, and you have to solve it to do some exact computation. Okay? So that sounds like there are three problems there. Topological string allows us to compute certain class of physical observable for superstring theory compactified on such manifold without knowing the metric explicitly. So it's circumvent the problem of not knowing the metric and not being able to solve the model exactly. And this is done with the help of supersymmetry. So I'll have to tell you a little bit about the supersymmetry in the space. So n equal 2 superconformal symmetry. Okay? So, so this is a conformal theory, so it is decomposed into left moving part and right moving part. So I'm just going to write down the generator for the left moving part. So left moving part of the generator consists of the energy momentum tensor, and then the U1 current, which is given by Gij bar with product of fermions, left moving fermions. Excuse me. Okay, so I should probably set the notation. So from here on, when I write psi, this is gonna be left moving fermion. And when I write psi bar, this is gonna be right moving fermion. Okay, so this is a product of left moving fermion contracted with a metric. And then you have a pair of supercharges. G plus is Gij bar, psi I del xj bar, and G minus is Gij bar, psi j bar del of xi. So this generates n equal to super conformal symmetry. And for the right mover, you just replace del bar by del, by del bar and psi by psi bar. And for example, this U1 current generator has operator product expansion, which is like n times z minus w square, where n is a complex dimension of the Carabiao manifold in question. And the central charge is 3 times this number. Okay, the fact that you can actually do some exact computation, even though you don't know, even if you don't know the metric exactly, was first, I think, pointed out by Ed Witten in his topological sigma model paper in 1988. However, I highly recommend you to look at his more later paper called Mirror Manifold and Topological Field Theory, 91.1.2056, which, and I'm going to follow the notation in this article. And so we are going to do what is called topological twisting. Which is to change the energy momentum tensor by adding a term proportional to the derivative of the current. Okay, and I'm going to explain various different way to, let's see so how this works, okay? So I'm going to explain what this topological twisting means later. So let's assume that this is a procedure that I'm going to employ. Saying that if I do this topological twisting, then it changes the dimension of the operator and see how this is going to work. So I realize that this is not an efficient way of doing it. Oh, I should have. This is this combinatorics is too difficult to figure out. So how do those dimension changes? Well, you had the G plus, which has which is of course the generator of supersymmetry transformation, so it should have the dimension of the supercurrent. And this dimension changes to the dimension of the ordinary current, and the dimension of the G minus changes in the opposite way, so it becomes 2-0. Okay? So in particular, this is G plus of is now the dimension of the current, so it makes sense to integrate this. And then define some operator. And the great thing is that you can do it for any curved two-dimensional surface because now it's a dimension 1-0 operator. So this is a covariant operation. So by the superconformal algebra, first of all, it's nilpotent. So you can consider cohomology with respect to that operator. And the second of all, this modified energy momentum tensor is BRST trivial. In fact, it is a transform of G minus. This coefficient 1/2 over there is chosen in such a way that this works. Okay? So this is just as if you have learned the perturbative string theory, then this is as if G BRST operator is a standard BRST operator of perturbative string theory worksheet, and G minus is anti-ghost, okay, for the bosonic string. Now, so I told you that I'm going to give you various different interpretations of the topological string, topological twisting, and one of which is that it is actually modifying the Lagrangian. So the topological twisting is the same as coupling, introducing some additional U1 gauge field on the world volume of a string, world sheet of the string, and coupling it to the U1 current that I wrote over here. That is that to add to the Lagrangian a term proportional to A bar J plus A J bar, where A bar is equal to 1/2 of the spin connection. This omega is a spin connection on the Riemann surface. And I'm going to leave it to your homework exercise to figure out that with this choice, natural energy momentum tensor is not T. If T was the original energy momentum tensor for this original Lagrangian, then with this modified Lagrangian, T tilde is going to be your new energy momentum tensor. Okay? So I'm going to leave it to your exercise to figure this out. Okay? Now, there are actually two different ways of doing topological twisting. I just mentioned one because I was focusing on the left mover only, but relative to how you do the topological twisting on the left, there are two different ways of doing topological twisting on the right. So these are called A-type twist and B-type twist. And actually, so I'm curious to know why Edward used this notation, because later it turned out that this one is closely tied to type 2A, and this one gets tied to type 2B. So I was wondering whether he was aware of that connection when he introduced this notation.
It may have been just lucky. I can't remember for sure.
Okay. So in any case, so in the case of A model, T tilde is T plus 1/2 of del J, and the T tilde bar is T bar plus 1/2 of del bar J bar. So you're going to twist the left mover and right mover in the same with the same sign. So that means that in particular, the BRST operator is integral of G plus and G bar plus. Okay? So the worksheet fermion, you see that there is a psi I and psi I bar, etc., has also the following dimension. Psi I has dimension 1-0, and psi I bar has dimension 0-0, for example. And you can figure out those dimensions. So you can ask what this topological BRST transformation means on the world sheet theory. So we can evaluate that. So for example, variation of this bosonic coordinate xi, maybe I was using small character, so del of xi is equal to, so if I define BRST transformation in this way, then this is equal to epsilon times psi I. And similarly, delta of xi bar is epsilon of psi I bar. And delta of psi I is epsilon times del bar of, excuse me, psi bar. Oh, sorry. So I get mixed up with indices. This is equal to epsilon of del of xi bar, and then del of psi bar I is equal to epsilon of del bar of xi. So this is a topological BRC transformation we are interested in. And you can read it in various different ways. First of all, I would like to pay you, I'd like you to pay attention to the super BRC transformation property of this fermion operator, because requiring that BRC transformation of fermionic operator is zero means that the configuration is super BRC invariant. So in particular, BRC invariant configuration means that the del bar of x is zero, and the del of xi bar, you cannot read it, I guess, but there is a bar here. Oh, I made it worse. there is a bar here. So that means that in the case of A model, in the case of A model, BRST invariant configuration means that del bar of x is equal to zero. Namely, the map should be holomorphic. Okay? You can play the same game for the B model. And in the B model, the BRC transformation is slightly different, because now T tilde is T plus 1/2 of del of J, but T bar tilde is T minus 1/2 of del of J. So this changes the dimension of the operator and therefore changes the definition of BRC choice of BRST operator. And in particular, del xi is BRST invariant. And del of xi bar now transforms as epsilon of psi I plus psi I bar, psi bar of I. And del of psi I is equal to, oh, what did I do? Psi I bar plus psi bar of I bar, excuse me. And this is equal to epsilon of del of xi and psi I bar, psi bar of I is epsilon of del bar of xi. Okay? So this is a transformation. So what does it mean? So let me transcribe what I just wrote over there. So I said, in particular, that in the case of B model, the BRST transformation of psi I is epsilon of del of xi, and BRST transformation of psi bar I is epsilon of del bar of xi. So that means that if you want a BRST invariant configuration, for the map x, both del and del bar has to be zero. So that means that x has to be constant. So what it means is that originally sigma x was a map from Riemann surface to the manifold. But xi constant means that it gets mapped to a point. So the entire Riemann surface gets mapped to a point in the target space, and that's the whole BRST invariant configuration. Okay? So this is going to be important later. Okay, so now the interesting thing that is we're going to exploit later is that there are actually large class of Calabi-Yau manifold which has mirror pairs. It's not actually known whether every caraviao has mirror pair or not. I'll tell you a little bit more about that later. But quite often we can find a pair of caraviao called mirror pair. And that means that A model on M is equivalent as a quantum field theory. That means that Hilbert spaces are the same, and operator algebra on that is the same. That B model equivalent to the B model on W. Okay. So that's going to be an interesting concept that I will explore later. Now, since we have a BRST operator, not only we'll be interested in understanding what is a BRST invariant configuration of the field, but we would also like to know what are the BRST invariant operators so that we can evaluate their correlation functions and other things, which we will later connect to physical type 2 superstring computation. So let's discuss BRST cohomology. In this series. Well, first of all, I would like to note that since energy and momentum tensor after topological twisting is BRST trivial, so that means that the dimension of the operator has to be zero. Because if the dimension of the operator is non-zero, there is not invariant under T, so therefore such operator cannot be BRST invariant. So we just look for a dimension zero operator, and in a perturbative limit, it's easy to figure out. Because let's consider, for example, A model. Well, in the case of A model, what are the dimension zero operator? Well, here is a dimension zero operator, for example. And then there is a right moving counterpart of this would be dimension zero operator. And also, well, X itself is sometimes difficult to think of this as operator, but any function of X, normalizable function of X, would be dimension zero operator, at least in the perturbative limit. So this leads us to see that the natural choice of dimension zero operator would be of this form. Namely, where you take the left-moving holomorphic fermions and right-moving fermion with anti-holomorphic indices, contract that with some arbitrary function of X, but it has to transform accordingly so that this will be globally defined in the space-time. And then in this case, you can ask how this BRST operator acts on this space. Well, that's easy to figure out because first of all, we see that psi I that I used over here is by itself BRST invariant because this is BRST. And so therefore, I think I made a mistake. Maybe this should have been Burr. So this, this was correct. I'm sorry. Yes. So. Okay, so what this means that if you do perform a BRST transform of this thing, then well there is X dependence in here. So for example, omega can depend on X. Okay? Now suppose I do BRST transformation, then I'm gonna take derivative variation. So that means that I have to take derivative of this and multiply del X. But variation of X is psi itself. So it's going to be multiplied by psi. But this is nothing but the exterior derivative operator, if you think of this as a basis of differential form. So from that, you can figure out that BRST operator acting on this combination of the operator is nothing but del plus del bar, which is a D operator. So BRST operator act on this operator as exterior derivative operator. So therefore, naturally, the BRST cohomology is nothing but the Hodge-Durham cohomology of the space, where this P and Q are nothing but J and J bar charges. Okay? You can do the same thing for the B model. And in view of the time, I'm going to skip the detail. But if I do the same thing, then you find that in this case, BRST operator is equal to del bar. However, it is acting on this kind of space. Namely, del bar cohomology, but with coefficient in the antisymmetric product of holomorphic part of the tangent space. In the case of Calabiau, actually, this turned out to be related to this Hodge-Drum cohomology, which is sort of the basis of the mirror symmetry. OK, any questions so far? Yes, please. No, this has, in the perturbative sense, psi I z psi j bar w would have a single pole. Zero-zero operator, but it's paired up with 1-0 operator. Okay. So therefore, the Green's function would be dimension 1 operator, which is given by this. On the other hand, x would have logarithmic correlation function. Okay? Any other question? Yes, please.
Is there a known formulation where this BRST symmetry appears as after gauge fixing of some large symmetry, of some large gauge?
Yeah, you can consider coupling to topological gravity, and then this appears naturally as a, well, actually, I'm not saying it correctly. This is not that symmetry. So you can actually guess what it is. So let's see. So for example, you can actually guess from the structure of BRST operator what the symmetry would have been. So here, for example, you have a theory that starts with the gauge invariance, which shift x bar to be by arbitrary vector. Okay. So then actually such theory would be trivial, right? Because you cannot write a Lagrangian to it. And in fact, if the original action that I wrote would be trivial locally, you can actually write it totally as a trivial action. And that is obviously invariant. But non-triviality comes from the fact that the globally it's non-trivial function. But you can actually derive this kind of, so this is actually, I think, very nicely explained in Witten's paper, series of paper on topological field theory, where you can define, so here you can clearly see that the gauge transformation that you are gauging is replacing this fermion by the gauge parameters. And similarly here, so in this case, for example, you are considering the gauge theory where the original coordinate is transformed arbitrarily locally. So that is why it is topological in some sense, because you don't have a you are starting out with a theory where you don't have any local degrees of freedom, because these are all gauge. That is in some sense why it's topological. Any other question? Okay, so now let us discuss then deformation. Let us start discussing deformation of the theory. And this is an important part of the discussion, because what we would like to understand is the following, what we'd like to achieve is the following thing. So we want to compute various physical observables using this technique of topological string. And in the end, what we would like to end up with is some kind of function or section of some bundles over the moduli space of Calabiau manifold. So the answer we'll be getting will be function or section over moduli space of Calabiau manifold. So we'd like to understand what is the space in which we are evaluating these things. Okay, so that's what I would like to describe now. Okay. So first of all, in order to discuss the moduli space, it would be useful to understand the tangent space to the moduli space, which is the space of infinitesimal deformations. In the language of quantum field theory, these are marginal deformations. Okay, so let's start with the A model. Okay, so in the case of A model, the physical operators are of this type, right? The BRST operators are of this type. And in particular, the marginal deformations are generated by H1 element of H11 for the reason that I'm just going to explain. So this is one of these physical operators, BRST invariant operator, where both P and Q are equal to 1. Okay? So suppose you choose an element of this H11, where there are, so let's call the dimension of this by small h. So this is 1 to H11, where H11 is a dimension of this space. I guess those of you over there cannot read it, but it's called capital H11. And now define this operator phi a, which is ka I j bar psi I psi bar of j bar. Okay? And this is an example of the operator of that type. So in particular, this is BRST invariant. And this carries a charge 1, 1 for the left and the right mover. Okay, so that now what I'm going to do is to multiply g minus and g bar minus on this operator. And if you compute this operator product and using the standard perturbative computation, then you find that this is going to be equal to ka of ij bar del xi, del bar xi bar, xj bar, plus terms that contains fermion. So you can see that this is as if you deformed the metric of the target space by the amount proportional to Kera form, kij bar. Okay? In particular, this is 1-1 form on the Riemann surface. And this is also BRST invariant, because if I do the BRST transformation of this operator, then what happens is that BRST transform of G minus is the energy momentum tensor that I wrote up there. So that means that if you do the BRST transformation, this becomes del or del bar acting on, namely, this is going to become total derivative on the Riemann surface. So that means that if you integrate this just as you do in the Lagrangian, then this will be a BRST invariant deformation of the action. So you can multiply this by some arbitrary parameter, sum over A, and claim that this is going to be the deformation of the action that you'd like to do. And so this preserves BRST symmetry. And since the original operator has dimension 1, 1, by multiplying operator of dimension minus 1 over here, you get a neutral operator. So this also preserves the U1 symmetry. So this will be a nice marginal deformation to the theory. And in the case of A model, this TA becomes scalar moduli, which is a combination of Kera class parameterizing the size of the original Calabi-Yau manifold and additional configuration of the NAS2 form field, which I will discuss maybe later. Okay. However, this alone does not give you real deformation to the action, because in the original Hermitian property of the n equal 2 theory, the complex conjugation of this will be G plus, and you have a phi bar to it too. So in fact, in order to preserve reality of the action, you have to add complex conjugation of this. And G plus is a BRST operator, So this is actually a BRST trivial combination. So so at this level, it doesn't matter whether you add it or not, but later it plays some important role, so I'm just introducing that to here. So this will be the deformation, and if you include both T here and T bar here, then we can parameterize the Lagrangian by TA KA of IJ bar del XI del bar XJ bar plus TA bar KA IJ bar del bar X, del of XJ bar del bar of XI plus terms containing fermions. So as you can see, if you So T is multiplied by this, and T bar is multiplied by this complex conjugation. And so normal kinetic term would be sum of them. And the difference of that would be so-called instanton term, which counts the number of worksheet, number of times a worksheet wraps around the non-trivial two cycle in the target space. So this will be the moduli space of the A model. So moduli space of the A model is parameterized, infinitesimally deformed by the element of H11 in this way. Similarly, maybe I should write it over here. Similarly, in the case of B model, the deformation is generated by del bar of 0, 1 with holomorphic with coefficient in the holomorphic part of the target space. So the element of that can be expressed as some function which depends on I bar and j. And well, if you are familiar with some perturbative string theory, then you may recognize that this is an analog of Bertrami differential on the Riemann surface. When you parameterize complex structure on the Riemann surface, you use some kind of tensor called Bertrami differential. And this is the generalization of that concept to higher dimensions. So from this kind of description of marginal deformation, you see that if you have a truly BRST invariant amplitude, then such an amplitude would depend only on T here, and not on T bar here, because this would be BRST trivial. Okay? So that means that the BRST invariant amplitude would be holomorphic in T. So you get some kind of holomorphic object over moduli space. So you see that BRST invariant object would be holomorphic in the target space. And in the case of holomorphic, not in target, holomorphic in the moduli space of the target space, which in the case of A model is a Kähler moduli space, and in the case of B model, it's a moduli space of the complex structure. Now, so let's look at the case of A model a little bit more detail. So if you consider A model, well, the object is can depend on, observable can depend on T and T bar, because these are the parameter of the marginal deformation. But invariant, independent of T bar, so that means that in particular, you can take T bar goes to infinite limit. You can take the limit where T bar is infinite, and the answer should not depend on how you do it. But if you look at this part of the action, where did I write? Oh, did I just erase it? I am afraid I just erased it. So what I was writing over before here was that in the case of A model, the Lagrangian is equal to T times K times del X del bar X bar plus T bar of K of del bar X del X bar. So in particular, if you take T bar goes to infinity, then this term is very much suppressed. So in the limit of T bar goes to infinity, therefore, since T bar couples to, as I said, since T bar couples to del X bar del bar X, so in this limit, the only configuration that survives is a configuration where del bar acting on it is equal to zero, namely holomorphic map. And that fits well with what I said earlier, that I wrote somewhere, maybe I mentioned somewhere over here, that here I said that BRST invariant configurations are holomorphic maps. And indeed, if you actually compute the BRST invariant observable, then you find that it's independent of T bar, so you can take the limit of T bar goes to infinity, and then you land at a holomorphic object. Now, how about the B model? In the case of B model, here the BRST invariant configuration is a constant map. So what does it mean that, so what does it mean? So in quantum field theory, you do path integral for all configuration of the wall sheet field. But if you are computing BRST invariant observable, only BRST invariant configuration should contribute to the functional integral. In the case of B model, the BRST invariant configuration is a constant map. So then you have to integrate over moduli space of constant map. So you have a map to a point in the target space. So that means that moduli space of this map should be just the target space manifold itself. So that means that any BRST invariant observables can be expressed as just plain integral in the target space. So therefore, in the case of B model, the truly BRST invariant observables are just classical integral. It's a finite dimensional classical integral in the target space. Okay, so I guess this is about a good place to start. So I just wanted to tell you that in the case of, so to summarize, we see that when we consider the BRST invariant observable, in the case of A model, it is expressed as sum of a holomorphic object. In the case of B model, you get integral, finite dimensional integral over moduli space. Now, the object that I'm going to deal with in the context of topological sigma model is almost a BRST invariant, but BRST invariance is very subtly broken by the existence of some kind of anomaly that I will tell you tomorrow. And because of that, there is going to be some interesting modification to this story. That will be the story in the next tomorrow.